FC Girondins de Bordeaux are an institution of French football. Six-time French champions and 17-time trophy winners in total, their former alumni includes the likes of Jean Tigana, Alain Giresse, and Zinedine Zidane. Quite literally, then, some of the greatest French footballers of all time. Bordeaux won their sixth French championship in only the 2008-09 season, just 15 years ago, bringing Lyon's run of seven straight Ligue 1 titles to an end. The following season, Bordeaux beat Juventus and did the double over Bayern Munich, condemning the former to a spot in the Europa League, en route to topping their group in the UEFA Champions League, and as recently as the 2018-19 season, Bordeaux were still competing in the Europa League, following successive top six finishes. And yet, just a few years on, FC Girondins de Bordeaux, a club that was founded over 100 years ago, is no more. It is one of the biggest fatalities in football history, up there with Rangers, Napoli and Fiorentina, with potentially much more damning and long-term consequences. Last week, following an administrative relegation from Ligue 2 owing to their financial outlook, which was previously the lowest level that the club had ever played at, Bordeaux entered administration and voluntarily gave up their professional license. It means that every one of Bordeaux's players, from the first team through to their youth ranks, is no longer contracted to them. They are forced to shut down their academy and youth centre, which is one of the most famous and prestigious in all of France, and it remains unclear at which step of the French Football League pyramid an amateur Bordeaux will be allowed to compete in next season, if indeed, as is currently a major concern, they are allowed to return at all. I made a video about Bordeaux's downfall and the existential threat facing the club a little over 2 years ago, in March 2022, back when they were in the Ligue 1 relegation zone. I rarely make follow-up videos on this channel, but given the magnitude of what has happened to Bordeaux, the wider significance of it in terms of what it means for the sport as a whole, and the sheer number of requests that I have received since the news about Bordeaux spread like wildfire online, today is a rare exception. So sit back, relax, and join me on a journey to one of the most picturesque and bourgeois cities in France as we take a look at how Bordeaux have gone from toppling a Juventus team of Buffon, Cannavaro, Del Piero and Trezeguet, and a Bayern Munich team of Lahm, Robben, Ribery and Closer, to ceasing to exist and vacating their professional status that they had held since 1936, all in the space of less than 15 years. Olympique de Marseille are the only French club to have played more games and won more points in Ligue 1 than Bordeaux. That makes Bordeaux the French equivalent of Arsenal in England, Borussia Dortmund in Germany, Inter Milan in Italy, and FC Barcelona in Spain. Bordeaux's six league titles is also the same number as Chelsea and Valencia, more than Borussia Dortmund during the Bundesliga era, and twice as many as either Napoli or Roma. Before PSG's Qatari takeover in 2011, the Parisians had only ever won two top-flight league titles. That should put the scale of Bordeaux, and their demise, into some perspective. During the 1980s, Bordeaux won three Ligue 1 titles in just four seasons, as well as a couple of Coupe de France titles, beating Marseille, in consecutive finals at the Parc des Princes. This was a Bordeaux team which featured French internationals like Patrick Battiston, René Girard, Thierry Tissot, Jean Tigana, and Alain Giresse, and was managed by Aimé Jacquet, who went on to guide France to glory in his last act in management at the 1998 World Cup. In the 1984-85 season, Bordeaux reached the semi-finals of the European Cup, where they were only beaten 3-2 on aggregate by eventual winners Juventus. This was a golden era for Bordeaux, but there would be plenty more good times to come. After dropping out of the top flight for a single season at the beginning of the 1990s, Bordeaux bounced back to win a fifth Ligue 1 title in 1999, with a team that featured the likes of Ulrich Ramé, Sylvain Wiltord, and the unforgettable Johan Mikoud. Wiltord and Mikoud departed for Arsenal and Parma in 2000, a familiar occurrence for Bordeaux, who grew accustomed to losing their star players. But time and time again, they recruited and developed well, which was bolstered by one of the finest academies in the land. As good as Bordeaux were throughout much of the 1980s, In some ways, the 2008-09 season was an all-time high. Lyon had been utterly dominant during the 2000s, winning 7 successive Ligue 1 titles, which included pipping Bordeaux to the title by just 4 points the previous season. Both Lyon and Marseille had significantly larger budgets than Bordeaux, but inspired by Johan Gerkuf, who was among the best players in world football that season, and aided by academy graduates like Pierre Ducasse, Mathieu Chalmé, Henri Seve, and Marc Planus, Bordeaux returned to the summit of the French game, winning their last 11 matches on the bounce. Technically, Bordeaux won their first treble, beating Lyon in the Trophée des Champions at the beginning of the season, and lifting the Coupe de la Ligue for the third time, thrashing PSG in the semis, and Van in the final. However, it was almost immediately following this high point, and Bordeaux's Champions League heroics the following season, that the club's fortunes began to turn. Gerkuf was sold to Bordeaux's former title rivals Lyon in the summer of 2010, but even more significantly, manager Laurent Blanc brought an end to his three-year stay in Gironde, eventually taking over as France's head coach following the 2010 World Cup. Since the late 1990s, Bordeaux had been owned by Metropole Television, better known as Groupe M6. Though the media group hardly bankrolled Bordeaux, their ownership was stable. They maintained a healthy academy, sold players for decent fees, and reinvested their transfer profits wisely. As the finances in French football escalated, though, most notably with the arrival of the Qatari state at PSG in 2011, Groupe M6 could no longer keep up. What's more, with the rise of the internet and alternative media platforms rivaling television, Groupe M6 decided to streamline their operations and focus on their core business. So following almost two decades of ownership, Groupe M6 decided to sell Bordeaux. In November 2018, General American Capital Partners, or GACP, a hedge fund based in Miami, Florida, announced that they had acquired Bordeaux for $82 million. The timing was interesting. It came following 9 months of intense negotiations, and just 6 months after the Ligue de Football Professionnel, the governing body which controls professional football in France, had announced an enormous new television deal with the Spanish company MediaPro. The deal with MediaPro, which we will come on to, given that it played quite a significant role in the downfall of Bordeaux, was the second most lucrative broadcast deal in football worldwide, trailing only the Premier League, and it inspired a wave of takeovers in Ligue 1, especially from American investors and asset management companies. General American Capital Partners, a little-known firm outside of America, and almost totally unknown in Bordeaux, weren't the only asset management firm involved in the deal. Though it wasn't revealed at the time, and despite being the face of the deal, GACP were only actually minority shareholders, owning just 14% of Bordeaux, whereas King Street Capital Management, a larger investment firm based in New York, with close to $20 billion in assets under management, owned 86%. Despite King Street being the majority shareholders, GACP still wielded significant influence, as their chief executive, Joseph DeGrosa, who now runs his own asset management firm out of Miami, DeGrosa Capital Partners, or DCP, held a veto on all major decisions taken by the club. Within 12 months of the takeover, however, there was a leadership dispute. King Street and GACP had different visions for Bordeaux, so King Street bought out GACP's stake, removing DeGrosa from the board and putting them in sole charge. There was a third party involved in Bordeaux's takeover back in 2018, also undisclosed, and that was the Fortress Investment Group, or FIG, a significantly larger still asset management company, also based in New York, with the best part of $50 billion in assets under management. Fortress was co-founded by Wes Edens in 1998, who is now the billionaire co-owner of the Milwaukee Bucks, Aston Villa, and Portuguese side Vitória. If all of these asset management firms' acronyms and initialisms are getting a bit confusing, as I said in my last Bordeaux video, I can only apologise. Basically, GACP were the face of the takeover from Grupa M6 in 2018. King Street were the actual majority shareholders, despite it not being publicly stated. They took full ownership in 2019, buying out GACP, and both the initial takeover and King Street's buyout of GACP was funded by the Fortress Investment Group. Now what, I ask you, is so confusing about any of that? Whatever dissatisfaction there may have been with Bordeaux's stagnation under Grupa M6, and their inability, along with everyone else, to compete with a PSG team bankrolled by a Gulf state, even before the confusion and opacity of their new ownership situation was revealed, there was little enthusiasm among locals for the deal. American, and particularly American asset management firms have, shall we just say, a less than exemplary record within French football. From Frank McCourt at Marseille to, more recently, 7-7 partners at Red Star and Blue Co at Strasbourg, there is a broad sense of distrust among French football fans that American investment companies, hedge funds and consortiums, A, know what they're doing, which is sometimes a misplaced concern, based upon the stereotype that Americans don't understand football, which is common throughout much of Europe, although, naturally, is sometimes correct, and B, that their sole motivation is to make money, which, well, I mean, maybe that suspicion will be proven wrong one day, but so far, it has been right every single time. The deal to acquire Bordeaux, given the club's size and support, the upcoming rights deal with MediaPro, and the value of their playing squad, was considered to be a bit of a bargain within the business world. During the 9 months of negotiations, Bordeaux had sold Brazilian winger Malcolm alone for €42 million, over half of the club's eventual sale price. It didn't really turn out like that, though. In King Street and GACP's first season owning the club, Bordeaux fell from 6th to 14th place, posting losses of €26 million in the process. This wasn't sustainable, but it also came as no great surprise. Even when finishing 6th, the season before the Americans arrived, Bordeaux still lost €21 million. In response, King Street made sales, allowing academy sensation Jules Koundé to join Sevilla for €25 million in the summer of 2019, followed by fellow youth team alumni Aurélien Tchouaméni, who joined league unrivals Monaco for €17.5 million in January 2020, with a further €2.5 million in future add-ons. This was viewed as a stopgap to get Bordeaux through to the 2020-21 season, when their revenue would inevitably rise massively due to the MediaPro TV deal kicking in. Or would it? Well, as you probably already know if you follow French football at all, or if you've just watched any videos about the plight of French football clubs on this channel in recent years, the LFP only received one installment of their new deal with MediaPro's payments, followed by two missed payments, before the deal was terminated. It is difficult to overstate the damage that the collapse of the MediaPro deal caused. Well, I suppose if you said that it was worse than the fallout of an all-out nuclear world war, or James Corden, then that would probably be over-egging things, but in the context of French football, it was pretty bad. The MediaPro deal, which was for 80% of Ligue 1 and Ligue 2 rights, was worth €780 million a season over the next 4 years. Factor in Canal Plus's remaining 20%, greatly inflated due to the price paid by MediaPro, and the LFP would be raking close to €1 billion a season. It put Ligue 1's broadcast revenue ahead of La Liga, the Bundesliga, and Serie A, and second only to the Premier League, in a move that LFP chiefs and Ligue 1 owners alike hoped would permanently alter Ligue 1's status as the lowest ranked and least lucrative of Europe's big five leagues. Serie A, incidentally, had been offered the exact same deal by MediaPro before Ligue 1, but turned it down in favour of a significantly lower offer after their due diligence unearthed concerns surrounding the company's economic viability. Imagine exercising less caution and savvy than the Italians. It's often said that the moment that the MediaPro deal collapsed, every Ligue 1 and Ligue 2 club, bar PSG, went up for sale. King Street likely never would have bought Bordeaux were it not for the MediaPro deal, and Fortress Investment Group almost certainly wouldn't have financed their takeover, nor a subsequent $50 million loan. Fortress's lack of faith in King Street and Bordeaux's ability to repay them after the Media Pro deal collapsed was made pretty evident when they offered to forgive the $50 million loan for just $30 million. Yeah, that's rarely a good sign. The LFP hastily negotiated a new deal for a cut price with Amazon, which left a more than €400 million black hole in the finances of France's professional football clubs. The LFP was willing to take that short-term hit in order to build up a long-term relationship with Amazon, who are giants in the streaming space, the third largest company in the world by revenue, and, therefore, one would imagine, significantly less likely than Media Pro to go bust. The only problem, and admittedly, it is a pretty big one, is that the losses that they were willing to absorb crippled virtually every team in Ligue 1 and Ligue 2. To make matters worse, in hindsight at least, the LFP's strategic long-term partnership with Amazon didn't bear fruit, with the league's rights from the 2024-25 to the 2028-29 seasons now in the hands of DAZN and beIN. Worse still, the cut price deal that they did with Amazon, which saw the American firm paying roughly as much as Canal Plus for four times as many matches, angered Canal Plus, rupturing that relationship as well. The LFP's new deal with DAZN and beIN is worth a combined €500 million a season, so about half of the Media Pro and Canal Plus deal for 2020-21 to 2023-24, which is significantly less than the deals negotiated by Serie A and La Liga, roughly half the existing Bundesliga deal, and less than a third of the size of the Premier League's current domestic deal. So, not great. While French football clubs were still reeling from that news and hectically trying to balance their books with greatly reduced revenue, there was a global pandemic. The pandemic impacted all clubs, of course, with virtually every league on the planet brought to a standstill before returning without any fans. But whereas the top flights in England, Italy, Germany and Spain were put on a long-term temporary hold, the 2019-20 Ligue 1 season was actually cancelled. That meant the pain, financially, was even more intense in France, straight off the back of the Media Pro devastation. Bordeaux finished 12th on a points-per-game basis, a slight improvement on the previous season, but nowhere near returning to Europe, and even with the fairly lucrative sales of Koundé and Tchouaméni, external shocks saw their losses spiral to €35 million. That increased Bordeaux's total losses to €82 million in three seasons, more than the $82 million that King Street, and GACP, had paid to buy the club. Having already sold their biggest assets, the only lever that King Street had was to slash costs. Four players were sold for a total of around €17 million in the 2020-21 season, which was still played behind closed doors, with a further three released. Meanwhile, Bordeaux didn't spend a single penny on incomings. In fact, the only players Bordeaux signed at all were Jean-Michel Seri on loan from Fulham and Hatem Ben Arfa on a free transfer following a failed stint in Spain with Real Valladolid. Off the pitch, King Street were living up to all of the worst stereotypes that French football fans have of American investors. At the start of July, Bordeaux unveiled a rebrand of the club's badge. It would be fair to say that Bordeaux fans had a mixed reaction, and when I say mixed, what I mean is that it ranged all the way from "I absolutely hate this" to "which putz and their idiots came up with this." Aside from not everyone loving the aesthetics, Bordeaux's executives, in their eternal wisdom, decided to remove the word de, or of, from the Bordeaux badge, as well as inverting the word Girondin and Bordeaux, meaning that, well, how do I put this? It was no longer the club's name. 11 days before the start of the season, manager Paulo Sousa walked out, owing to a serious dispute with the board. It doesn't take a genius to figure out some of the issues that that might have been about. The vastly experienced Jean-Louis Gasset, who spent 3 years at Bordeaux as Laurent Blanc's assistant, was appointed as his replacement in probably the best decision, and maybe the only good decision, that King Street made during their entire time at the club. At a time of chaos and tumult, Gasset brought some calm. Using all of his experience, working with an incredibly young squad, owing to Bordeaux's mass exodus and the forced promotion of U-team players in order to plug those gaps, he guided the team to a 12th place finish, albeit they were only actually 5 points above the relegation zone. Whilst games being played behind closed doors was financially ruinous for Bordeaux, for Gasset and Bordeaux's players, at this point, it may have been a blessing in disguise. Bordeaux fans, understandably, weren't exactly delighted with the club's sense of direction. Despite Gasset securing survival, Bordeaux lost a further €50 million in the 2020-21 season, taking their total losses to more than €130 million in four seasons, and a month before the season finished, King Street announced that they would stop funding the club's day-to-day operations, placing Bordeaux in administration. Normally, the DNCG, or National Directorate of Management Control, which is the watchdog that monitors the finances of French football clubs, would respond by automatically relegating Bordeaux, despite their league finish. The DNCG are famously, or infamously strict, requiring clubs to share with them not just their backdated accounts, but also their financial outlook for the upcoming season to make sure that everything adds up. It is the equivalent of when English clubs are put under a monitoring period by either the Premier League or EFL, having to consult with the authorities and report to them constantly, except that this is for all clubs, all of the time. It is supposed to prevent a situation precisely like the one that has just happened at Bordeaux. In Bordeaux's case, in April 2021, the DNCG showed some rare leniency in light of the MediaPro deal collapsing and COVID creating a perfect storm of financial ruin, even if Bordeaux had navigated it worse than just about anyone else. The DNCG gave Bordeaux a brief window, therefore, to source new ownership and new investment in order to provide them with a viable financial plan for the season ahead. Unfortunately, however, unlike back in November 2018, Bordeaux were no longer a particularly attractive proposition. The club's stature had fallen significantly, following multiple seasons outside of Europe and flirtations with relegation. They had amassed enormous debt, and, as we are about to come onto, they had a half-empty stadium which the club doesn't even own. As a result, in June 2021, Spanish-Luxembourgish businessman Gerard Lopez completed his takeover of Bordeaux. Regardless of the lack of interest in Bordeaux, this was a takeover that should never have been approved. Lopez is a man who kills football clubs easier than Harry Redknapp and with an even greater degree of personal responsibility. It should be said that this is where my last "What on Earth is Going On at Bordeaux" video left off, which featured this rather ominous introduction to a beautiful port city of castles, cathedrals, and vineyards as we get tangled up in the vines of a football club, Girondins de Bordeaux, that was once as elegant and grandiose as the city that it calls home, but now looks as ragged as Louis XVI after the Girondin had caught and arrested him, and risks meeting the very same fate. Not on the guillotine in their case, but at the hands of football's gods. Yeah. I wish that hadn't aged quite so well. It should be said, I didn't have a crystal ball, and it didn't take a genius to figure out that Bordeaux's predicament, combined with Gerard Lopez's ownership, was always likely to be a recipe for disaster. For the uninitiated, Lopez is a man who probably first came to most people's attention when he bought out the Lotus Formula One team in 2009, now Alpine, and became their president. Under Lopez's watch, Lotus famously promised Kimi Räikkönen a €50,000 bonus in his contract for every point that he won the team while he was driving for them. Lopez viewed it as a smart negotiating tactic to get a former world champion to race for Lotus, but he perhaps underestimated Lotus's car, Räikkönen, or both. Over the next 2 years, Räikkönen won an incredible 390 points, which included winning the Abu Dhabi Grand Prix, securing himself €19.5 million in bonus payments alone. The novel bonus scheme, combined with other reckless financial decisions, conspired to almost bankrupt Lotus, despite their performances on the track. When Lopez sold Lotus back to Renault in 2015, who rebranded the team back to Renault, it had several unpaid debts and was on the verge of collapse. Brace yourselves, you may start to notice something of a theme here. In 2012, when he was still the owner and president of the Lotus F1 team, Lopez announced his plans to invest €500 million in football, principally through the guise of a super agency. Likened to Gestifute at the time, the world's largest football agency, founded by George Mendes in 1996, Lopez's agency, named Kick Partners, set out a bold mission. The aim was to become the biggest agency in the world, with over 20 subsidiaries in the world's leading football countries, 5 to 10% of global market share, 50 to 100 million euros in net annual commissions, a payroll of more than 30 agents, and over 500 players represented. In a PowerPoint presentation that was shared with the Financial Times, a slide explaining the agency's name stated, quote, "That's why we are called Kick Partners. The opportunity is big. We will kick ass." Yeah, I know. Kick Partners' parent company was called Mangrove Founders, which Lopez owned 37.5% of, alongside Hans-Jürgen Schmitz, who was one of Lopez's two co-founders, and Mangrove Capital Partners, the investment vehicle that he co-founded in 2000, and Fidalk Investing, a little-known company with virtually no digital footprint, reported to be operating out of the British Virgin Islands. Kick Partners' strategy, like Gestifute on steroids, was to earn money not just via commission for acting on behalf of players, but actually to own the players' rights themselves. South America, where third-party ownership was more common, would be the target market, with Kick Partners' early investments including a 12.5% stake in future Brazilian international Gerson and a 30% stake in then-international academy player Alisson Farias, who now plays in the third tier of Brazilian football. In 2015, though, FIFA banned third-party ownership worldwide, putting a significant dent in the Kick Partners' business model, and just months later, Rawad Cassis, who was the lead agent at Kick Partners and the face of the company's early pitch, died in his mid-30s. In 2017, Lopez confirmed that Kick Partners, the agency that was supposed to become bigger than Gestifute, had ceased operations. When FIFA banned third-party ownership, Lopez shifted his attention to football club ownership, albeit with a very similar business model. The vehicle may have changed, a club rather than an agency, but the premise was the same, buying the rights of talented young footballers and selling them on for a profit. Up to that point, Lopez's only involvement in direct ownership had come at CS Fola S, a club from his native Luxembourg, which Lopez acquired in 2007, appointing himself as president. A 2 million euro payment that was made by the Lotus F1 team, owned by Lopez, to CS Fola Esk, a football team in Luxembourg, also owned by Lopez, which was subsequently transferred to a Hong Kong-based business owned by Eric Lux, who is the CEO of Genie Capital and co-founded the company alongside Lopez, led to criminal charges being made against Lopez in Luxembourg in 2022. Best not to skip too far ahead, though. In 2017, Lopez stepped back from his involvement in Fola S and instead acquired Ligue 1 side Lille. Like Bordeaux, Lille are famed for their academy output and player development, making them an ideal prospect for Lopez. Over the next 4 years, Lille raised roughly 350 million euros in player sales, with the likes of Nicolas Pepe, Rafael Leao and Victor Osimhen among their most notable departees. Nonetheless, by the time that Lopez sold the club in December 2020, Lille were $150 million in debt. It should be noted, just in the interest of balance, that Lille went on to win an unlikely Ligue 1 title during the same season that Lopez sold the club, a remarkable achievement, but that doesn't change the fact that he very nearly bankrupted them. Shortly before selling Lille, Lopez bought Belgian outfit Royal XL Mouscron, whom he relegated in his first season, and in his second, Mouscron were relegated to the fourth tier after being refused a professional license due to financial irregularities and being 10 million euros in debt. Lopez subsequently filed for bankruptcy, and Mouscron were dissolved. The club no longer exists, and the city of Mouscron no longer has a professional football club. Before bankrupting and folding Mouscron, Lopez also bought Portuguese outfit Boa Vista, who are one of only five clubs ever to have won the Portuguese Primeira Liga title. Boa Vista finished 15th in the Primeira Liga last season, level on points with Portimonense in the relegation playoffs, and avoiding that fate solely by virtue of goal difference. It is widely reported that Boa Vista ought to be facing an imminent transfer ban owing to the refusal of more than 30 payments on players. Lopez, who has been described as a friend of Vladimir Putin, also saw some of his companies reportedly named in the 2016 Panama Papers, and in 2022, he launched a tech company involved in cryptocurrencies. Of course he bloody did. Oh, and in August 2016, it was reported that Lopez donated £400,000 to the British Conservative Party as his friend Zach Goldsmith was running to become the Mayor of London. Goldsmith was accused of running a racist election campaign against the Muslim candidate Sadiq Khan, who Goldsmith tried to tie to extremism. This is the man, then, who has crippled virtually every sporting institution that he has ever touched, that French authorities took one look at as he attempted to acquire an already crisis-ridden football club and said, yeah, why not? What could possibly go wrong? As Lopez arrived, the experienced Jean-Louis Gasset, who had ensured Bordeaux survival the previous season, departed, and Lopez replaced him with Vladimir Petkovic, a man who hadn't managed in club football for 7 years. At the same time, further sales were sanctioned. Most notably Yassine Adli and Thomas Bassett to AC Milan and Lazio, meanwhile Bordeaux's first major signing in years, Fran Sergio, unsurprisingly a Brazilian, who set the club back a potential €7.5 million, was rated as one of the worst players in Ligue 1 in his debut campaign, having struggled to adapt. Petkovic was sacked in February and replaced by former Rennes boss David Guillon. It made no difference to Bordeaux's season. Just 6 wins from 38 games, 31 points, and a mammoth 91 goals conceded saw Bordeaux relegated in last place, bringing an uninterrupted 30-year stay in Ligue 1 to an end. Unlike at the beginning of the 1990s, Bordeaux failed to make an immediate return. Despite maintaining a Ligue 1 wage bill, Bordeaux finished third in Ligue 2 in the 2022-23 season, 3 points behind Metz in second. Last season, they fell to 12th, 18 points off automatic promotion, with a negative goal difference, and just 9 points above the relegation zone. At the end of the season, Bordeaux were administratively relegated by the DNCG, who no longer feel as lenient towards them as they did back in 2021, for failing to provide sufficient financial guarantees ahead of the 2024-25 campaign. Bordeaux's last hope was the interest of Fenway Sports Group, or FSG, another American holding company principally owned by investor John W. Henry, which also owns the Boston Red Sox and Liverpool. On the face of it, FSG's ownership of Liverpool, whilst extremely lucrative for Henry, in terms of the increase in the club's valuation during that time, has also been fairly positive for Liverpool, when one thinks of the mess that they were in under the previous ownership. Nonetheless, the idea of becoming the plaything within an American asset management firm's multi-club ownership model is enough to darken even the most optimistic of souls. Troyes, who are owned by the City Football Group, were only spared relegation from Ligue 2 themselves this season because Bordeaux were administratively relegated, giving them a temporary stay of execution. Meanwhile, Strasbourg fans have expressed their open displeasure as a proud club with immense heritage and support at having been reduced to the role of secondary or tertiary actors within a holding company, serving the interests of Chelsea and ultimately Bluco rather than themselves. In the end, even the FSG deal collapsed. I have alluded a couple of times during this video to Bordeaux Stadium, which I discussed at length in my previous Bordeaux video, all of which is still relevant, should any of you be interested in going further in depth about Bordeaux's plight prior to Lopez's arrival, but basically, Bordeaux left their old ground, the Stade Chaban Delmas, which had been their home since 1938, in 2015, in order to move into the Nuevo Stade de Bordeaux, or the Matmut Atlantique, as it is currently known for sponsorship reasons. A genuinely world-class stadium, which is currently hosting 7 games at the Olympics, the Nuevo Stade de Bordeaux, literally, the new Bordeaux Stadium, was built ahead of Euro 2016 at a cost of €183 million and has a capacity of a little over 42,000. Bordeaux didn't build the new Bordeaux Stadium, but they also don't own it. The stadium is officially owned by the City of Bordeaux, but it is run via a public-private partnership between the City of Bordeaux and the private consortium of Vinci and Fiat, which sees the council pay an €11.1 million annual stadium subsidy in a deal running until 2045. Pierre Hermitsch, the mayor of Bordeaux since 2020, who previously voted against that arrangement but was outvoted, has welcomed the idea of selling the stadium, but a deal has never been struck. In FSG's negotiations to take over Bordeaux, the stadium costs became a major inflection point. The city of Bordeaux were willing to forgive some of the money that they were owed on the stadium by Bordeaux, but FSG didn't feel those concessions went far enough, given the debt that they would be inheriting at Bordeaux and the scale of the club's economic mess. That leaves Bordeaux where they are now, with no new owners, no league, no professional status, no academy, and, quite possibly, no football club. Lopez took the decision to give up Bordeaux's professional status, after talks with FSG broke down, as a means of radically reducing Bordeaux's expenditure. The process of deprofessionalizing means the automatic termination of all of Bordeaux's senior and youth team contracts, a devastating blow to the club, supporters, and many of those players themselves, of course, but also an instant eradication of what was a €36 million expenditure in Bordeaux's last set of accounts, in which they lost a further €50 million. Without such a radical act, and without a sale, it is unlikely that Bordeaux would have been able to submit a satisfactory financial plan to the DNCG ahead of next season, though there are no guarantees that they will be able to do that even after relinquishing their professional status. Bordeaux still have to submit a viable plan for entry to the Championnat National, France's third tier, which is made up of a hybrid of professional and amateur clubs, or, more likely, the fourth tier, Championnat National 2, where the vast majority of clubs are amateur, in order to be granted entry to either league ahead of next season. It is potentially a rapidly developing situation, so close to the start of the season, but at the time of this recording, there are virtually no guarantees. Mayor Pierre Hermitsch is now actively looking for potential new owners, but the reality is that Bordeaux are now an amateur football club in €90 million of debt. The size of the club, their history, tradition and fan base, along with a state-of-the-art football stadium, even if they don't own it, makes it unfathomable that, at some stage, Bordeaux won't return to the professional ranks and most likely Ligue 1. Even in Ligue 2 last season, despite everything, Bordeaux still averaged over 21,000 fans at their home games, higher than six Ligue 1 teams. If they are able to find a buyer and put together some kind of coherent economic plan, the DNCG may well show them some leniency again, given Bordeaux's standing within the French game and the damage that their demise has caused to the image of French football. For at least the last 6 years, Bordeaux have been passed around the hands of murky and disinterested profiteers with zero interest in the club themselves, their supporters, or their future. For Bordeaux, that has proven to be fatal. Yet that exact statement could describe 80% of football clubs in France and an even higher proportion in England. The complacency surrounding the fragility of football clubs, as the vultures circle, isn't just misplaced, it is dangerous. Bordeaux's case is extreme due to a combination of particularly incompetent American asset managers and a man who has a penchant for killing football clubs that even Ted Bundy would find a little bit excessive, but in every other sense, they are far from alone. That is it for today's video, but thank you all very much as ever for watching. Hit the like button if you enjoyed it, let me know your thoughts down below in the comments. And of course, make sure that you are subscribed and have notifications turned on not just for this channel, HITC Sevens, but also my second channel, Alfie Potsama, both of which should be about to appear on your screens now. And you can also find me on Twitter, Instagram, and Threads via the username at HITC Sevens on all three, should you wish to do so. And all of those links plus a whole lot more should be down in the video description below. Cheers.